Hello everyone, my name is John Talbert. I'm the Christian Copyright Solutions Program Director, and I'm happy to welcome you to this Copyright Coach webinar on the beauty of blanket licenses for churches. This webinar is the fourth in a six-course series we are offering for the first time ever because it represents a dream that we've had for years, which is to provide an online college-level course on how copyright compliance impacts church ministries. Your instructor today is Susan Fontaine Godwin, the founder and CVO of Christian Copyright Solutions. She also serves as an adjunct professor at the University of Mobile, where she teaches Survey of Copyrights and Intellectual Property Law in the Worship Leadership Program. Good afternoon, Susan.
Thank you, John. It's so good to be with you today. And yes, I've wanted to bring my curriculum to an online webinar environment for several years, and I've been teaching college students for 5 years now, which has really given me a great deal of insight on how to unpack some of the complex concepts of copyright law.
Today's webinar is the fourth in a series of six, with one session being held every other week. We will also have recordings available for each webinar, and in case you missed our other three webinars, you can watch them online at thecopyrightcoach.com. We also have recordings available for each webinar, and if you missed any of the other three webinars, you can watch them on the Copyright Coach's website. An important part of our mission at CCS is education, and we have an extensive learning center on our website, www.thecopyrightcoach, with free downloadable fact sheets, videos, and idea kits. During this class, we're sure that you'll have plenty of questions, and we'd like to have time at the end of this session to answer those questions. On your GoToWebinar interface, I'd like to draw your attention to the Questions tab, and I invite you to enter in the questions that you have throughout the webinar. We'll do our best to either address those privately as they're received during a slide or address those at the end of the webinar when we have more time. Please type them in there, and please also let us know what role you serve in at your church or ministry. We have had an overwhelming response to these webinars, and we're thrilled to have all of you with us today. We greatly appreciate your commitment to honoring copyrights and taking time during one of the busiest year seasons of the church.
Also, I do want to mention that I am not an attorney, and we don't provide any legal advice or counsel in our webinars. We provide information on copyright, so you may want to obtain legal advice for your church that pertains to specific uses of copyrights in your church activities. One of the tremendous benefits of church blanket licenses is the blessing that they provide to churches and music creators. At CCS, part of our mission is to make sure writers and publishers get paid revenue for the use of their songs. When church music leaders do music right, they empower songwriters by supporting their ministries, which results in an even greater flow of new music for the church. It's a very practical way that you and your church can give music life. Over the years, I've really enjoyed visiting churches and talking with worship leaders and media directors about their copyright frustrations and challenges. Too often, we hear about what we can't do when it comes to copyrights. I'd like to hear more about what we can do. This was the lament of one of our church media leaders a few years ago. I listened to his frustration, and really it was a cry for help that's echoed by many church leaders, and I realized that I needed to change my approach to copyright education. The easiest and most powerful can-do tool for your church or ministry is the use of blanket licenses. But many church leaders are confused about what the various blanket licenses cover and do not cover. But with a little clarification, I think you'll see that these licenses make it simple and easy for you to understand what you can do legally without the hassle of requesting licenses on a case-by-case basis. So it frees you up to focus on enhancing your congregation's worship experience. So today, we're going to break down each license to help you maximize the coverage that each one provides. Now, a blanket license provides pre-approved, pre-cleared authorization for you to use a particular group of copyrights for very specific uses or rights. All the blanket licenses are based on an annual fee. You can use the copyrights covered in the licenses program during the term of your license. If you do not pay and renew after 1 year, your right to use the copyrights is terminated. Some licenses require detailed reporting on the copyrights you use during the year. Some licenses require no reporting. Each blanket license outlines exactly what you can do in the license terms and conditions. Each of these blanket licenses represents a solution that was created by copyright owners and a third party in order to simplify legal use of copyrighted material by the Christian community. So if we're going to help you maximize the use of these blanket licenses, I think there are some important keys to planning and strategy in the way that you do that. And I've identified five different key elements to planning and strategy to make the most of these blanket licenses. Number one, you need to plan and budget. You know, just like you would plan the year for your creative activities, you need to plan for how you're going to use those blanket licenses and make sure you budget it for it. Number two, you need to identify what your activities are in your church throughout the year and the different ways that you are using or want to use copyrighted material. Number three, identify the types of copyrights and exclusive rights that involve the way you're using those copyrights. Number four, understand any exemptions that your church may qualify for. And number five, create a mosaic of coverage so that when with all of these various blanket licenses, you maximize the coverage in which you are copyright compliant.
Thank you, Susan. That's great information. One of the questions we receive quite often is regarding your first point, planning. In a ministry environment, lead time is not always in abundance, and sometimes teams are still making changes to their song selections days and even hours prior to an event. Could you speak for a moment about how long prior to the use of a copyright a church or ministry should start the licensing process?
That's a great question, John, you know, I think that it raises a very important point, and that is that when you want to use a copyright in a particular way, if it's not covered by a blanket license or you don't have that blanket license, then you need to allow anywhere from 3 to 4 months, in many cases, to get clearances on a specific copyright because you have to do the research, find out who owns it, you know, contact them, send them all the information about how you want to use it, and quite often, you'll find that it might take you 3 months before you actually have the clearance. So with a blanket license, as soon as you sign up and pay for that license, you are covered for the copyrights under that license and for the specific ways that the blanket license allows you to use it. So it's a great solution. I mean, for example, today, if you decide, you know, you want to stream your Easter program or a special event of any kind, if you signed up for a streaming license today and paid for it, you would immediately have coverage. So it's a very good question and certainly one of the benefits and advantages of a blanket license. Now, before we dive into the details of blanket licenses, the ones we're going to look at today, I think it's important to have a brief summary of a very important exemption. And we did talk about this in our last webinar, but for those of you who missed it, we want to have a brief review of what we've discussed in the past couple of webinars, so you understand what activities may not require licensing and where you need licensing. These are important building blocks that will help you leverage and use blanket licenses correctly. So first, let's look at the elements of the religious service exemption. And with the religious service exemption, I like to read the specific language because it is legal and it's important to understand exactly what is said. Performance of a non-dramatic literary or musical work, or of a dramatico-musical work of a religious nature, or display of a work in the course of services at a place of worship or other religious assembly, shall not constitute infringement of copyright. And I love to color code things, and as I say, try to break down and unpack some of these legal areas or understanding what is being said here. So I've color-coded this so that everything in red is a copyrighted work. It's a type of copyright. Everything in green is a type of exclusive right. And everything in blue is about the place and setting, the location and setting. So let's break that down a little bit with our three building blocks, the three basic elements. Number one, we have to look at what types of copyrights are covered under the exemption. And as you can see, there are 8 works of authorship that can be copyrighted, and only 2 are included in the exemption. literary works, which are things like speeches, poems and prose, articles, excerpts from a book or novel. These are all considered literary works. Musical works are identified as music with any accompanying lyrics, so basically the songs we sing in church, as well as the instrumental music. Now, the dramatical musical work of a religious nature is very specifically something like, let's say, a music or operetta, but a musical work, a sacred work of some type. I like to use Jesus Christ Superstar as an example, even if some people might take issue with that theology. It's basically a dramatico musical work of a religious nature. So very specifically, those are the types of copyrights that are included in the exemption. Next, we need to look at what is in green, which are the exclusive rights that are covered or identified in the exemption. There are 6 exclusive rights of the copyright owner, and only 2 of these are included in the exemption. The performance right, which means the right to play or perform the music in that religious setting. The public display right, the right to display a work. And in this case, it's only literary works, or it could be the lyrics and music to a musical work. So those are the exclusive rights that are covered. The third, which is very important and pretty unique to the exemption, is the location and setting. And so what we see there is that the language is pretty specific, that it needs to be during the course of a service, a religious service, at a place of worship or other religious assembly. And so that would cover you playing and performing music in your worship service, in your place of worship. Now, that doesn't have to be in a church. You could meet and have your regular religious assembly in a hotel, conference room, or, you know, some other venue. But those are the definitions for the location and setting, and that's very important. That's unique to the religious service exemption, but it's going to come into play a little bit with one of the licenses or a couple of the licenses that we will talk about. So once again, it's important when you're looking at blanket licenses to use these 3 questions, and there's 2 other questions we're going to talk about, that to act as a filter to ask the questions of what is covered by the blanket license and what is not. So that's an example of how to identify whether you color code or you, however you break things down into understandable components or elements. You could do this same technique, to be honest, with blanket licenses if you have questions and you're trying to understand exactly what's covered. So what do we need to know about a blanket license? How do you analyze and break it down? Well, we've seen how to unpack and break down the religious service exemption. So what are the elements that you need to break down for blanket licenses? Well, there are 5 key elements that we want to look at. The first being, just like the religious service exemption, what type of copyright is covered in that license? The second is what type of right or rights are included in the blanket license. The third is, what is the specific catalog of copyrights that are included in that license program? It's a very important question that you need to look at. So, for example, if you're looking at a congregational blanket license, you need to know what catalog of songs, what songs are included in that agreement that they have the right to convey and authorize you to be able to use them. It could be a group of films that are included, or a group of songs, or a group of sound recordings, but you need to know the specific catalog or catalogs that are included. The fourth question is, what are the specific uses? And so, for example, there are several licenses we're going to talk about that are very specifically for congregational singing purposes, and you need to look at that. Or there's another license that's for rehearsal copy purposes. So you need to understand the specific uses. Are there limitations on that? And of course, the fifth item you need to look at through this lens or filter for all of your blanket licenses are, what are the terms in the agreement under terms and conditions? What are the terms? Are there specific limitations? Are there specific rights that aren't included? And also, what are the fees for that annual license?
Susan, that's a lot of great information, and I'd like to answer one of the questions that's come in, which is whether or not this information is available in some kind of printed format or in a document that can be shared with other members of a church staff. And we're happy to say yes. As I mentioned at the beginning of the webinar, our Learning Center at Christian Copyright Solutions has quite a few great fact sheets that are available in downloadable format as well as for printing, so that you can share them with your church staff and review this information later. All of that information that we are going over today in this webinar is included in a fact sheet called Understanding Blanket Licenses. And again, you can find that at the Learning Center at ChristianCopyrightSolutions.com.
Thank you, John. And we find that, you know, you may be attending this webinar on behalf of your church staff, and it's a lot of information to process and try to understand. You want to follow up and have something in writing and in print, as well as you may want to take it back to your team or decision maker in your church. And so that's one reason we've developed those fact sheets. Now, another question that comes up quite often is why so many different licenses? And you may wonder why there are so many different blanket licenses, because I often hear, gosh, it would really be great if I could just go one place and get one license to cover everything. I mean, we want to do it legally, but why do we have to go all these different places? And while I agree, you know, currently it's pretty much impossible to have just one license. As we've discussed, there are 8 different types of creative works that can be copyrighted. We went through them, you know, on that screen. And basically, you have music, sound recordings, literary works, audiovisual works like film and video, visual images, paintings, 3D sculpture, photographs, drama, dance and pantomime, and even architecture. So you can imagine you have all these various works that are owned and managed by a lot of different groups and people, and they have all different rights and considerations. And so it's pretty much impossible at this point in time to go one place and get one license for all these different types of copyrights. In addition, you have 6 different exclusive rights that are owned by the copyright owner, or they are the rights of the copyright owner, such as copying and duplication, or reproduction, performance, which we've talked about, distribution, derivative rights, display, and performance of digital sound recordings. So it's important to be able to identify the type of copyright authorized for use under the blanket license. And as you can see, these exclusive rights quite often are managed and controlled by different groups. You know, for example, the performance rights are managed on behalf of writers and publishers by the performance rights organizations in the United States. And there are 3 of them, ASCAP, BMI, and CSAC. And so there are a lot of reasons why at this point in time it's pretty difficult to figure out how we might have one license to cover any type of copyright you want to use in any way that you want to use it. But how did blanket licenses even develop? Because prior to the 1980s, the mid-1980s, there were no blanket licenses available for churches, or very small groups of them. For example, when I was at Integrity Music, we did have a blanket license for church congregational purposes, but it was only our copyrights, and so it was only one group of, you know, 1,000, 3,000 copyrights, and it wasn't comprehensive. But in the mid-1980s, it all started with one blanket license for congregational singing of Christian worship songs, for some of the basic reproduction rights. But as worship and creative arts ministries have become more creative and innovative over the past 20 years, copyright types and uses have emerged as potential copyright infringement hazards. As a result, new blanket licenses have been developed to provide various solutions for multiple activities. In general, there isn't much duplication between the uses covered by the various licenses. There are some, and I'll explain that in a little bit. The coverage provided by your blanket licenses can be viewed as a mosaic of coverage in which the edges touch but do not overlap. And so when you understand what's available and what you want to do at your church, it can really release you into creativity, knowing that you're copyright compliant in the activities that you want to do. Now, I will say there's a very common misunderstanding in churches and ministries that if I get one license or just one of these licenses, I don't need to get any of the others. The truth is that the basic licenses we will talk about today do not overlap. in copyright coverage. Each license covers a different type of copyright, a collection or group of copyrights, and/or the exclusive rights or activities. In many cases, churches need all of the available blanket licenses. We will look today at the four basic types of blanket licenses and explain the differences among them. We'll cut through the confusion and clarify what you can and cannot do. You'll then be able to maximize the use of each license's rights and feel confident and secure about how to make the most of each one. I do want to note that it's very important to always check with the source for information about each blanket license. Like, each company has very good websites and fact sheets and FAQs online, as well as customer support. So if you have questions about any of the licenses, you should check with them and especially check their terms and conditions so you understand what it covers and what it doesn't. Okay, we're going to get started with all of the licenses that grant right for the use of music. So we're going to cover and focus and zero in on any of the blanket licenses that cover that one of the eight copyright types, which is music. Music with any accompanying lyrics. We will start with the CCLI church license. It's the first type of license, and it covers Christian songs or worship songs for congregational singing purposes. And there are three different types of these licenses with three different companies that we want to talk about. But they go into the music rights of reproduction and duplication for some very common uses for congregational singing. Now, the CCLI license is a great solution for more than 300,000 worship songs for congregational purposes. And you'll notice on each of these slides that in the upper right-hand corner, we have a box that zeroes in on those three questions, three of the five questions. What type of copyright? What is the exclusive right that's included in this license? And what's the catalog size, or what's the group of copyrights that are included? Now, I will say on this license, we've listed reproduction, but there are some limited derivative rights that are included, and I'll explain that in just a second. By the way, on this license, as well as many of them, the annual license fee is based on the size of your congregation, and it allows churches to reproduce songs in the CCLI program for congregational singing. So you can print songs, hymns, lyrics, in bulletins for congregational singing, make custom songbooks for congregational singing, make visual format for projection of lyrics for use in congregational singing, arrange, print, and copy your own arrangements for songs used for congregational singing where no published version is available. So that's a derivative right, making an arrangement. And the fifth one is to translate songs where there's no published version. That's, I think, recently been added, which is great because more and more churches want to translate songs from, you know, English into Spanish or French into English or whatever the case may be. The sixth right is to record your worship services, and there's some limitations on that, and that's where it's important to understand your agreement that provided you only record live music and do not reproduce accompaniment tracks. So it's designed for recording your worship service. And you can sell those for up to $4 for CDs and $12 for videos or DVDs. And you can make up to 10% the size of your congregation. So if you have a church of 1,000, you can make up to 150 copies. And I know that originally publishers granted this right because, you know, for shut-ins or people who couldn't make it to church and they wanted to hear the entire service with worship, with the worship music. And so I think that's a great right that's included. Once again, if there are any questions, you want to be up to date on any of these licenses and what they offer, be sure to go to their website. Sometimes churches are confused about the types of activities covered by the CCLI license as well as other licenses. So it's important to understand what is not covered, and you can refer to CCLI's website, FAQs, terms and conditions on what is and is not covered. And certainly you could call their support line as well as any of these companies. But it is the church leader's responsibility to understand what your license does and does not cover. All right, let's look at another license that's very similar. It's for congregational singing. Once again, it's for music. It's the reproduction rights. And in this case, it covers about 100,000 songs. And that is the licensing license. I will say that from our understanding, the songs are from about 340 Christian song publishers. including OCP, Hope Publishing, New Dawn, and NALR. It was created by a partnership of four independent agents serving churches around the world. And so in this case, there may be some catalogs and songs that you may not find in the CCLI license or the other license that you want specifically to be able to use, and so that's why you may want to get this license. In that case, you may want two licenses. That's a situation where these are very similar rights that are conveyed or authorized, and so you may want both of them. You know, once again, you can print bulletins, make custom song books, and project lyrics. And you could go to their website in order to see exactly what their rights are. Once again, we have another blanket license for congregational singing purposes. It's called One License, and it is for music, for the songs, reproduction rights, and they cover about 62 publishers. Some programs feature many liturgical. This song program features many liturgical and denomination publishing houses like GIA, FEL Publications, and Liturgical Press. So if you have a liturgical setting, there may be some songs in these catalogs that you want to be able to use, and you'll want to check on their website and find out exactly what they cover in their program.
Thank you, Susan. Again, as you mentioned, you know, these licenses may not cover all of the rights and all of the uses that a particular church needs. And so one of the questions that we had was, you know, really determining which of these licenses is going to be best for the print rights and the display, creation of displays that we need for your church. And as you mentioned, referring back to licensing and One License and CCLI's websites for those particular catalogs and song titles is the best option for those people that are considering which of these print or reproduction style blanket licenses that they should pursue.
Yes, John, that's a really good point, and I appreciate you mentioning that. Our next license we want to move into is also a music license. In other words, the copyright type is for music, but it does involve a different exclusive right. And as we discussed earlier, the U.S. copyright law includes the religious service exemption in Section 110.3, and it's very important for churches because, as we said, it allows you to publicly play or perform music, whether Christian or secular, in the course of services at a place of worship or a religious assembly without obtaining permission from the song owner. It does not, however, include activities that are for social, educational, fundraising, or entertainment purposes. So many churches today play and perform music outside their religious services. You know, it's really such an enhancement in the church life throughout your facilities and activities to be able to play and perform music. And we found more and more churches are doing that. So CCS, with the partnership of the U.S. Performance Rights Organizations, ASCAP, BMI, and CSAC, created a one-stop comprehensive perform music license in 2008 to provide a simple, one-stop, and inexpensive license for non-exempt song performances. So as you see, music is the copyright. It's for on-site performances, playing and performing music publicly anywhere in your church facilities, and it's 17 million plus songs from all of the PROs, ASCAP, BMI, and CSAC. And I will say that Christian songs are included in that. So I would imagine most of the songs in the CCLI program or One License or licensing are included because they are affiliated with one of the three performance rights organizations. So with this license, you can perform or play songs in your facilities, music before or after services, for concerts, on hold music, in your bookstores or coffee shops or anywhere in your facility. Maybe perhaps in an aerobics or dance class, seminars and conferences, receptions and dinners, social functions, VBS and children's programs. The activities go on and on. Pretty much anything where you want to play or perform music, anywhere in your church facilities or satellite campus facilities would be covered by this license. What you cannot do is charge an admission to a concert, although there is an add-on license that allows you to do that with some additional reporting. And you cannot perform dramatic musical works because the PROs are not authorized to do that. Okay, the next license is also a performance license, and it is the WorshipCast license for webcasting or streaming your performances of music on your website. Once again, the type of copyright is music. The performance right, the exclusive right, is specifically internet or streaming performance, a digital performance online, and the catalog, once again, is 17 million plus songs, Christian and secular. So in response to the growing trend that we saw of churches webcasting their worship services, CCS partnered in 2006 with ASCAP, BMI, and CSAC to create this the only comprehensive one-stop internet performance license with 17 million Christian and secular songs. The PROs offer a special internet or new media license, which is distinct from their facilities or premise license, and which is covered by the perform music license. So we like to say that all of your performance rights are covered on site and online with the CCS performance licenses. With this license, you can webcast or stream worship services, concerts and events featuring your performances of more than 17 million songs. You can stream archived audio files or stream them live, so long as you cannot allow that to be downloaded from your website. The songs must be performed by your own musicians and singers or artists who have granted permission to use their recordings of the song. What you cannot do is download MP3 or digital song files. You can't webcast or stream third-party sound recordings or accompaniment tracks, and you cannot stream lyrics online. Okay, so there is another streaming license or webcasting license that we'd like to talk about. And, you know, it's kind of, I think it's great for churches that when you think about 15, 10, 20 years ago, not having any of these blanket licenses, that so many great licensing solutions are available to churches today. It's really a blessing, I think, that has simplified the process for churches and ministries. So the CCLI streaming and podcast license by CCLI requires an active church copyright license. This license grants the additional rights needed for churches to stream and podcast songs that are in the CCLI catalog online. The streaming and podcast license does grant the rights to stream your performances of catalog songs and worship services, to podcast your performances of catalog songs in worship services. And once again, you can find out more about what is and is not included in their license by checking their website. And as I mentioned, this is a streaming performance license, and it is for 300,000 plus worship songs. The next license is a license that CCLI developed and launched, I believe, in 2011. And it's one that churches have wanted for a long time. There's been a real need for it. It is a rehearsal license because many churches want to make copies of a recording of a song in order to practice and rehearse. And so this was launched in 2011. It's a great licensing solution. It is, instead of for music, instead of for the song, it is a license that the copyright is the sound recording. And so the catalog is 120 plus record labels that have authorized CCLI to allow these recordings to be reproduced or duplicated for rehearsal purposes. So the license does allow you to make copies of CDs, to burn CDs from commercial CD recordings, to burn CDs from digital downloads, to upload recordings for listening via web-based worship planning software, and to email digital files to worship teams. It's very important to understand that this is for rehearsal copies of commercial audio recordings to their musicians, and it is intended for rehearsal purposes only and are not intended to remain as permanent copies for personal collections. I do want to edit what we have on this slide because I understand that it's 188 record labels that are participating in this license at this time. So that's getting to be a larger and larger number of sound recordings, which is great. And there are some restrictions about downloading the songs or providing recordings to musicians for their personal use. That's not allowed. Very good license, and one that I think churches have really benefited from. Our last license is unique because it does not cover the music copyright, but instead it covers audio, visual, or films and videos. The CVLI license was created in response to many churches wanting to show films and videos in their services and at various church gatherings. And once again, the copyright type is audiovisual. The exclusive right is specifically performance, and so you can't reproduce or duplicate or copy those videos, but it's for the right to show them. It includes 400-plus film producers, and you can get details at their website at cvli.com. Covers the performance rights for many film producers, and I think there are two different packages available depending on your use and activities and how large your size of your church. What you can do is use selected movies to illustrate sermon points, and that can be a portion of a film or the entire film, but you can't edit that video. You can use it for Sunday schools and youth groups and other groups to view the latest videos. You can show videos for teaching and training in educational classes. If movies have multiple producers, permission is needed from all copyright holders. And as I said, you can show films in whole or select portions, or where specific titles have been advertised or publicized. What you cannot do is reproduce a copy of a video or film in whole or in part, and you can't take that film and synchronize it with another medium. You can't take a film and say, make it part of your video or make it part of your multimedia presentation, because that would be reproduction rights. You're not allowed to charge admission to view the movies, and you can't advertise or publicize specific titles. And I understand you can't show videos or films on TV broadcasts or on the internet. Once again, I encourage you to go to each one of these websites and make sure you understand the agreement, the terms and conditions, as well as the details. If you have any other questions or details, sometimes there are some gray areas, if you will, that really you have to go to the source and ask the specific question to get clarification. What we try to do here is give you a broad overview of how many types of copyrights and groups of copyrights, as well as the rights that are involved that you can utilize. Because I really believe strongly that the church today has a tremendous opportunity to have the most comprehensive coverage that they probably ever had. And to do that with blanket licenses and to make the most of those and maximize that is a tremendous blessing to you as a church, as well as to the creators of copyrighted works. In many cases, the creators of music, the songwriters, the publishers, the artists, the record labels, as well as in this case, with CVLI, with the film producers, that you can participate in supporting these creative works and supporting the artist and the musician and the songwriter is really a wonderful opportunity the church has, that really outside of the church community in the secular world, you don't have quite this kind of opportunity to participate in supporting creative artists. And so I think it's amazing and wonderful that we have this many blanket licenses that have been launched and developed by copyright owners in conjunction with companies like CCLI and licensing and One License and CCS. We believe it's an opportunity to really bless the creative works, and you can participate in that. So I really hope you'll make the most of these blanket licenses that will help you become free in your creativity and not feel like you're constrained all the time with what you can't do.
Thank you, Susan. All excellent information that I know will be very helpful and useful to our participants in this webinar. We've got a lot of great questions. The first question that I'd like to address today comes from Les Scott. They mentioned, when using any of these blanket licenses, what are the reporting responsibilities to the user?
Very good question, and I appreciate that, Les. Each license has very specific instructions on reporting, and whether you're getting a license from CCLI or CCS, when you get that license, you will have information in the agreement, as well as usually with communication with that company, that shows you and explains to you how to report. I know that we have an online reporting mechanism. I think some of the other licenses do as well, so you can keep up with it week to week as you go. I think that if you're using a software, a worship planning software type of system, there often are downloadable. You can take what you've done with your set list, download it into and import it into your reporting mechanism. I know we're working on that right now with one of the companies, and anything we can do to make it easier for you, because it is very important that you report, because that's the way that the proper songwriters or artists are going to receive their royalties. But each license explains exactly what you need to do with reporting, and there are usually ongoing communication with you as a license holder that kind of remind you that the reporting period is coming up and that, you know, how to report, what you need to do. I know with our licenses, we usually have a reminder going out. We have a tutorial that explains how to do the reporting online to keep up with that. And it is very important because we want to do everything we can to get as much music usage data, in this case, you know, much reporting as possible, so the monies can be paid out correctly to the right authors and publishers. So thank you for that question, Les.
Our next question is about the church video license. Kelly Shepherd asks whether there is a stipulation for when a showing of a film would be a public instead of a private viewing. Is there a particular number of people that must be present before the CCLI or CVLI license is needed?
Okay, Kelly, well, that is a good question, and I don't have the answer to that, and I'm sure that CVLI can give you an answer. I don't know of any kind of, you know, restriction as far as the number of people, like if it's over 25 or anything like that. I don't know of that, but once again, I think you could call the CVLI number and ask that question. That's what I would recommend.
Thank you, Susan. We've gotten a couple questions about content that's available on YouTube or copyrighted images that are available through Google. Is there a particular license or additional permissions that are needed if a church is utilizing music that is included in YouTube content or including video content from YouTube in their worship services?
Well, that is a loaded can of worms. Number one, there's a lot of questions. There's several layers to those questions. And so I'm going to have to kind of dissect that a little bit. Number one, with YouTube, and there's a lot of news and articles, and there's been a good bit of debate over the last several years about YouTube. User-generated content is typically what it is called, UGC, when somebody uploads a video to YouTube. Within the terms and conditions, YouTube specifies that, you know, if you're uploading anything, you are responsible for copyright clearance of that material that you have in your video. And they, and you know, if there's music that YouTube identifies that has not been cleared or licensed, they will oftentimes take that down, because there's been a lot of pressure from music publishers as well as the record labels to not allow uploading of illegally used material in somebody's video. So one of the things that you face when you want to use a video that's from YouTube is that a third party has created this video, and you don't really know if the material has been legally acquired or used or licensed. Because you don't really know unless it's your material. So that creates a bit of a high-risk issue because you can't really control that. You don't really know. Now, I will say, if you are in a church service and you're showing a video that's live from the internet that is available on YouTube and all you're doing is showing it, you're not reproducing it, I believe there would be a great deal less liability with that. Another question you mentioned, however, has to do with visual images and finding an image through Google, through a Google search. And I would like to address that, because I was talking to a photographer just the other day. I ran into a photographer, a friend of mine, and you know, she was talking about what a challenge it is with her copyrighted photographs. How do you prevent people from copying what I call the right-click copy-paste syndrome if you're right-handed? And you find something on the website, and because it's available and accessible does not mean it's okay to use it. You know, it could be a copyrighted photograph that someone else has found and posted, and unless you get permission from the owner of that photograph, you really shouldn't be just right click copy paste or screenshot and taking it and using it somewhere on your website or with your material, because it is a copyrighted work in most cases. It's much better to use a service like iStock Photo, or there's various services where you can get an image and pay for it and you know you have the rights to use it. So I do caution you on that. There are a lot of good questions, and the YouTube question, there's a lot of different layers to it. So some of which I would want to defer to an attorney, someone who gets a little more, is more knowledgeable in the legal nuances of it. But that's what I would say about it.
Thank you, Susan. We have another question about the CVLI license. One of our participants records the services that they use in their church onto DVD and then uploads them to their channel on YouTube. But would CVLI cover those videos by the original artist that may be included in that video capture once it is uploaded to their channel on YouTube?
Well, once again, I would refer you to CVLI on that question, but it's my understanding that the streaming of videos is not included in this license. It is the right to show it, you know, in your facilities. Any clarification, I would check their website and try to talk to someone there, get a, you know, customer support question, but that's my understanding. And that's a good point because, you know, quite often people think, well, you know, the religious service exemption applies to our worship service and we want to stream that so it's okay. But it really does not apply. It stops at the facility or the location where you're having your live worship service. It does not extend to being able to transmit it by radio, television, or internet, or to stream it. And I think that same principle would apply.
Thank you, Susan. I have a question about the distribution of materials. When using the portion of the CCLI license that allows you to record your service, are there restrictions on who you can distribute those materials to, in addition to the restrictions you mentioned earlier about the amount of money you can receive as compensation for those materials?
I don't know of any restriction on who you can distribute it to. I mentioned that the initial kind of intent was, you know, where people weren't able to attend the service or they weren't able, maybe they were homebound or something like that. But that's not my understanding. That's not written in as a limitation. I think if, you know, the number limitation is a factor, but I believe you can distribute it to anybody. I don't know of any limitations in that regard. And I think, once again, I would check their agreement or talk to someone there, but I don't know of any restriction in that area. I mentioned the original intent back, you know, which is really probably 28 years ago, goes back quite a ways, but I don't believe that limitation is in the license, so I don't want to confuse you on that.
Thank you, Susan. There's a question about the particular rights in the CCLI license about when there is no published version available, whether or not that is for the arrangement of a song or for the translation of a song. The question asks if we are using that part of the CCLI license to make an arrangement, would there be any additional permission needed from the copyright holder at that point?
I just had this conversation with one of my students last night, and it is one of those areas that are a little bit gray, and I know that originally there were the publishers who conveyed the rights to CCLI. You may say, well, why does CCLI have these limitations? Well, the owners of the songs are the ones who say, okay, we're going to give these specific rights to an organization like CCLI or CCS, and so they're limited by those rights or limitations. And once again, I would really ask CCLI, a representative, about that. I think the idea is this. If a company, a music company, has gone to the trouble, and many of them are in business creating choral product, creating print product for churches, I say many of them, there are fewer today than there used to be. There are, you know, several that they create that product. And so they didn't want to cut off that product by conveying, you know, the rights for any custom arrangement. Where I think it's a gray area is that if you are looking for, you know, make an arrangement and your band is maybe you have two guitars and a bass and drum and flute player and, you know, whatever the configuration is, and there really isn't a published custom arrangement that fits your requirements. Maybe it's a full orchestra or it doesn't fit the group that you have, then is it really a published arrangement because you're not able to use it? It doesn't fit what you're trying to do with the group you have. I think that that's probably the key. If on the other hand, you have a, I'm just giving an example, you have a full orchestra and a company has published a full orchestration of a song, then they want you to use that arrangement. Once again, I would refer you to CCLI for more insight into exactly how that works.
Thank you, Susan. One of our questions is about the Perform Music License whether or not that license would give the permission that's needed for distributing printed lyrics at a Bible study or in a private home. Is there any information or any suggestion that you can give to whether or not that would be necessary or additional rights would be needed for that type of copyright use?
Right. Well, okay, that's a good question, and I will say there's a couple of components to that. Number one, the Perform Music License does not convey any reproduction or duplication rights. It's only the right to play and perform the music, and so that's the delineation. So when you want to go and make copies of lyrics or reproduce them, then that is not covered by the Perform Music License. It certainly would be within the context and within the rights of these congregational singing blanket licenses, like One License and Licensing and CCLI. That is one of the rights that's conveyed to reproduce the songs. Now, going into a Bible study that is not in the church facility is not a problem, you know, because it's really a part of your church ministry. Then there is the question, when it comes to public performance rights, if you're in someone's home, in a small group of friends and family or in someone's home, then that really is outside the context of the public performance rights, because that is defined as, you know, a public gathering that's beyond the scope of a, you know, fairly small gathering of friends and possibly family, like a social gathering. So as far as needing a performance license for something like that in your home, you probably don't need that. But for reproducing lyrics, you know, that would probably be covered under one of the congregational singing blanket licenses.
Thank you, Susan. While we're talking about congregational singing, we did have a question come in about whether or not that would include all singing during a worship service, including those performances just by a choir or by a soloist or a small group.
That's a question I've heard for a number of years, and once again, it's designed for congregational singing purposes. Someone last night was asking me about it. Well, if we put, you know, we're doing an ensemble or choir performance, which isn't really considered congregational singing, but if we put the lyrics up on the overhead and, you know, the congregation joins in, well, then that is congregational singing. Once again, it's one of those gray areas, and I used to work with a church, a large church, several years ago where we did get print licensing for custom arrangements where it was really their choir performing and it wasn't congregational singing. And that would seem to be outside the context of those licenses. But I would check with any of those blanket licenses to ask them that specific question. I mean, in some ways, there's a bit of a way around it, I suppose. If you have an ensemble performing, but you've got the lyrics up there and some of the congregation might be singing along. But when you get to those nuances and gray areas, I really encourage you specifically to go to the source and ask them that question.
Thank you, Susan. We're running low on time, and there's two other questions that I want to address before we move on. One of the last questions is if you could speak briefly about the differences in Stream by CCLI and Worshipcast by CCS, besides the number of songs that are covered? What are the differences in rights granted by those licenses?
Okay. I would encourage you to kind of look at both of the licenses side by side and what you can and cannot do. There's some advantages to each. Obviously, the size and scope is one big difference. You know, worship songs versus 17 million songs, but you said you already see that difference, so I understand. The CCLI license is streaming and podcast, and so podcasting is allowed. The Worshipcast license, podcasting rights are included for the performance rights, but not to download the podcast. And so that doesn't allow downloading a podcast version of your worship service. I think another difference is probably that the CCS license covers streaming of music for any event or purpose. It doesn't have to be just your worship service. It could be a concert, it could be a special event, it could be just that you want to stream your performances of music on your website. And so that's a little bit broader. So as I say, there's some advantages to each. I believe, if I'm not mistaken, John, maybe you can join in here. I believe that the CCLI streaming license allows streaming of lyrics, and our license, the Worshipcast, does not. In some cases, we know churches that have both licenses for, you know, various purposes, and with the tier level annual fee, in some cases, that might be a great solution. Because, you know, depending on the size of your church, the fees vary, and certainly the smaller churches, the fees are pretty low for both licenses. But those are, I think, some of the primary differences. I think that right at this point, you know, the CCLI streaming license is just for your worship service. Ours can be kind of any event, but there are some advantages to the CCLI license as well.
Thank you, Susan. The last question that I wanted to address was about using accompaniment tracks. In the event that a soloist or a group is performing on a streamed service, is there a license that would allow those soloists or those groups to perform with an accompaniment track that's available to churches right now?
John, that's almost an embarrassing question, because I realize we should have had another slide for another blanket license here. It is good for you to understand that sound recording or accompaniment track is in fact different than the song. And so if you're using an accompaniment track while you're singing that song, it is a separate type of copyright. It is not covered by the Worshipcast license or the CCLI streaming license. We do have a recording, sound recording license for streaming. We've partnered with Lifeway for a number of their accompaniment tracks and their sound recordings. It will not necessarily be all sound recording accompaniment tracks, but I think there's a group of about 1,200 that are covered, and you will find that on our website under the Worshipcast license. There is information about the Lifeway worship track license. You may be able to find help there. If it's a sound recording that's not included, you would have to get permission from the record label. Or if you happen to do this, you know, quite a bit, you might be able to get a license, an annual license from Sound Exchange, which has been authorized by the U.S. Copyright Office in the streaming performance, the digital streaming performance right for sound recordings. So those are a couple of ideas.
Thank you, Susan. So much great information today in the webinar. And thank you, everyone, for the wonderful questions. That was really a great follow-up to the content for today. I do want to let everybody know that they should go ahead and circle the date on April 14th, where the Copyright Coach by CCS will be presenting the fifth webinar in our series, which will be Copyright Planning and Budgeting. Again, Susan, thank you so much for being here. I'll let you address this as we close out.
Thank you, John. I really wanted to just thank you so much for being here. It's a big commitment, especially in the middle of Holy Week as you're preparing for a lot of programs and pageants and productions coming up during the week and on Easter. And I really just wanted to ask God to pray, and I wanted to pray and just ask God's blessings upon you this week as you minister, as you work, as you serve unto the Lord, as you are making every effort to make this Holy Week and the Easter celebration a time of great joy and rejoicing and blessing for many, and especially for those who are often not in your church and coming to visit. We ask for God's anointing and blessing to be upon you. We thank you so much for being with us today, and we rejoice with you in your ministry unto the people of God and those who are searching for the Lord. Thank you so much for being with us.